Be standing by for your go for the high gas work.
Roger. Set, man. Jerry, one for RMS.
Go ahead, TJ.
Yeah, this sequence, I've seen this happen before, just the way it goes. We end up with a risk roll of 343 instead of what it has in the book there. And just didn't want him to have any concern about that. It works fine this way when we go to release.
Okay, we copy that. Thank you.
And you challenge your word go for the high gain deployment. If you could give us a rough idea when it was going to come out, we'd appreciate it.
Learning. That's what Space Camp is all about. But not learning like you're used to in school. It's learning by doing, by experiencing new things and new ideas. Camp trainees spend much of their time learning about the tools and teamwork necessary for exploring space. In the Space Camp Training Center, which is located just a few miles from the shuttle launch pads of the Kennedy Space Center, campers experience the sensation of lunar exploration, investigate the world of zero gravity, and have a lot of fun. While at Space Camp, there are many things to see and do, like touring the rocket garden, learning new science facts at the exploration station, and visiting one of the largest astronomical observatories in the southeast. There are the launch pads of Cape Canaveral, where the United States began its exploration of space. And the Vehicle Assembly Building, where the space shuttle is prepared for launch.
And then the command module and the lunar module would separate. The lunar module would land on the moon, and the one astronaut would orbit in the command module. On the moon, the astronauts would carry out a variety of experiments.
Come on out here and give me a salute. Big Navy salute. Off the ground, on the floor. There we go.
Training at Space Camp begins with a sampling of the high-tech hardware, which is used to practice for simulated shuttle missions. Astronauts in the Apollo program use similar equipment to practice walking on the moon, where a person's weight is 1/6 of what he weighs on Earth. This can present a problem for an astronaut working in a bulky spacesuit.
Okay. I have a tough time walking up there.
Campers experience the thrill of lunar exploration in the microgravity or 1/6G chair. The microgravity training chair uses springs and weights to offset 83% of the trainee's body weight, so they feel like they were walking on the moon. Astronauts used equipment like this to train for excursions on the moon during the Apollo program.
really good.
This event is called the Large Space Structure Event, wherein the teams get together to plan, design, and construct large space stations. As you can see, the teams are in the final stages of design and construction. This afternoon's structures vary from deep space exploration stations to medical labs to simple structures where people can get away from the Earth just to experience space. We are about to begin the presentations in just a few minutes, and remember, like everything else at Space Camp, teamwork is the key, and the team that works best together is usually the winner.
It lets us do experiments in space and microgravity. You will learn all about this database in our presentation. The cost is $20 million. The living area. The bunks are bolted down and the people are strapped in. The solar-powered lights are placed so that they light a large area at one time. The hangars are upside down so that the clothes go up in weightlessness.
The escape pods are located in the middle of the database. If any real danger happened to come along, they can get five people in a pod. There are six pods. They eject toward the Earth's atmosphere and six parachutes open and it lands in the nearest ocean. Each pod has a heat shield all the way around it in case it goes out of control in the atmosphere.
The way the Saturn database is put together is it's disassembled on Earth and then shipped up in the payload bay of shuttle and then assembled in space. The transportation to and from the database is by shuttles and miniature rockets that launch from the docking area and come back to the docking area.
There are two main satellites. They can be converted to solar panels if needed. They can send or detect messages up to 230 miles into space. In every room and docking bay, they have phones and TV monitors next to them in case there are certain pictures, like if you're here and you have to send a map to the turbine room, you don't have to walk all the way there.
Saturn database gets their energy from the sun located, the solar pods are located over here. It gives energy to lights, phones, computers, anything that uses power inside the base. These are the life support systems right here. We have the oxygen and nitrogen tanks in this compartment. The oxygen and nitrogen exit through the vents, so they mix and form air. The fuel cells on the ship, the station, provide power while they also produce water.
Food is kept fresh in refrigerators. They keep food fresh for at least 3 weeks. The food is cooked in microwaves which are run on solar energy. Waste management facilities are conveniently located throughout the premises. No clothes will be washed. Showers may be taken in plastic bag-like showers filled with water.
Oxygen is pumped into rooms by oxygen tanks. The exhaled carbon dioxide goes into a vent and then to a greenhouse. The green plants change the carbon dioxide back to oxygen. The oxygen then goes back to tanks and the cycle starts over. Emergency oxygen is stored in an extra compartment with extra green plants.
There is a rust pulmonary orbiter. And also, there's waste management utilities for your convenience. There is water and other drinks served on the orbiter journey.
I'm talking about the waste facilities just now. The waste facilities, the tanks, are here. They have these different tanks, the water, the plastics and containers and the organic waste. One of our main objectives was to keep the price down, so we took and instead of making like processing plants and things inside the facility, we just have the tanks for about one month, so that every like month we have shutters for them and they can clean.
This is the picture of our Saturn database, and it's labeled with the living quarters, the generators, and the solar panels. And are there any questions?
Okay, what you are seeing now, Dave, and everybody down there, are the two EMUs that we're going to use for the EVA tomorrow. Dave being EV1 and Kathy being EV2. So we're going to hook up the lower torso and the helmet, hook up the SBUs, and we're going to go through a pressurization check, make sure that everything works. Go ahead.
Okay, O2 is EVA.
One of the most important aspects of spaceflight is the life support system that makes it possible for astronauts to live and work in the hostile environment of space. Campers try on an early pressure suit to see how heavy and bulky those suits are in Earth gravity. The early spacesuits were custom fitted, many needing more than 70 measurements before the suit could be manufactured. The space shuttle suit of today has many improvements over the previous models. It was designed with interchangeable parts and can be assembled in the proper combination for each mission to fit individual astronauts. That means one suit can be used over and over again on many different missions. Up and down are words with little meaning when working in the weightless environment of space.
I can hear away. Clear content. There you go. I did try to get a real good angle, dude. Okay, stop. Now go up just a little bit.
Okay, go on.
Stop. Okay, brakes are coming on.
Trainees use the 5 degrees of freedom simulator to experience the freedom of movement the astronauts feel in space. Simulators using the same technology are still used by astronauts to practice for spacewalks. The 5DF floats just above the floor on a cushion of air, giving the trainees freedom to move in several directions. They can work right side up or upside down.
Susie and Val say it's time for Jimbo and Pinky to come in and get their hands washed for supper.
Sounds like a winner. We got steaks on tonight.
Learning to adapt to life in space also means adapting to the special diet eaten by the astronauts. Food for spaceflight withstands conditions not common on Earth. During the week, campers are given an astronaut meal that consists of freeze-dried chicken and rice, green peas, peaches, and freeze-dried ice cream. Although some campers like it more than others, this gives each a taste of what it may be like living on a space station in the future.
David, why did you want to come to space camp?
Learn more about astronauts and space.
Okay, what's your favorite simulator?
The 1/6 gravity.
How come?
Chair. I don't know, it's just fun jumping in it.
Jeff Oblak, driving machine.
Okay, Jeff, why'd you want to come to space camp?
Because I I'm a lot interested in space. I wanted to learn how the astronauts take off and what about the program.
What's your favorite part of space camp?
5D astronauts.
Okay, Brad, why did you want to come to space camp?
Well, because I wanted to learn more about space and astronauts and what they do.
What's your favorite part of space camp?
Probably the 5D astronauts.
I'm Teddy Hartman and I'm from Voorhees, New Jersey.
All right, Teddy, why did you want to come to space camp?
I wanted to learn more about space and what astronauts do and things like that.
What's your favorite part of space camp?
5D astronauts.
How come?
Because I like spinning around and see what it's like, upside down, things like that.
What do you think of space food?
Well, it's okay, and I'm not one for trying new
things. I'm Brian Duffney, and I'm from Dryden, Michigan.
All right, Brian, why did you want to come to space camp?
To learn about space.
What's your favorite part of space camp?
The 1/6 gravity chair.
Stephanie Fisher from Muskegon, Michigan.
Okay, why did you want to come to space camp?
To learn more about space and to meet new people.
What's your favorite part about space camp?
The mission. How people are watching.
What do you think of the space food?
It's not bad.
Bad?
It's okay.
Do you like any part of it?
Ice cream.
Marcy's
running from Muskegon, Michigan.
Okay, Marcy, why did you want to come to space camp?
Because I'm really interested in space.
What's your favorite part about space camp?
Doing the mission and being with the counselors.
My name is Andy, and I'm from Michigan.
Okay, Andy, why did you want to come to space camp?
To learn more about space and the astronauts and how they work into space.
What's your favorite part about space camp?
I'd say going on the 1/6 gravity chair.
I'm from Charlotte City, North Carolina, basically.
Okay, Jason. Why did you want to come to space camp? What do you like best about space camp?
5D
astronauts. My name is Jason Clark, and I'm from Venice,
Florida. Okay, Jason, why did you want to come to space camp?
Because I thought it would be interesting, and I'm planning to have something to do with, like, space and airplane labs.
What was your favorite part about space camp?
Well, it's hard to say. I think I like the, you know, different kinds of simulation, like the simulation of the orbiter and the moon walking. That's about all of it.
Becca Mendel from West Virginia.
Becky, why did you want to come to space camp?
To learn more about space and how astronauts train.
What's your favorite part about space camp?
Going on the mission.
How come?
Because of, like, you were in the whole thing.
3, 2, 1, solid motor ignition and liftoff.
At the launch site near space camp, team members prepare to launch their model rockets. These 1- and 2-stage rockets, which use solid fuel engines, can soar 1,000 feet into the air before their parachutes pop out and the payload flutters back to the Earth.
3, 2, 1!
Yeah.
have main engine start. 3, 2, 1. We have SRB ignition and we have liftoff. Liftoff of mission 41D, the first flight of the orbiter Discovery, and the shuttle has cleared the tower.
Roll in. Roger, roll.
Mission control confirms roll maneuver. Velocity 22,000 feet per second, altitude 58 nautical miles, downrange distance 600 nautical miles.
Now it is finally time for the mission. Crew assignments have been practiced and the campers are ready for the countdown. This simulation allows the trainees to demonstrate their understanding of a space shuttle mission. Each group is judged on how well they perform as a team using all the training they have been involved in during the week.
What is the flight deck status?
Mission specialist 2 is ready.
Pilot is ready.
Flight, this is Discovery. All onboard personnel are go for launch.
Thank you, Discovery. What is the status of mission control?
Launch systems are achieved. All systems are go.
Instrumentation and communication systems are go.
Pallets and payload systems are secure.
Mid-deck experiments and gas cans are stowed and ready.
Where are we? Hydrogen system.
Ignition systems are on.
T-minus 10 seconds. 8, 7, main engine start, 4, 3, 2, booster ignition and liftoff of STS-35.
Roger, liftoff, engines at 104%.
Discovery, you have cleared the tower.
Begin roll program.
Pilot.
Roger, Max.
Better.
Roger, go for throttle up. Engines to 104%. Discovery's altitude 22 nautical miles, 14 miles downrange, velocity 3,400 feet per second. Discovery now 26 miles high, downrange 17 nautical miles, velocity 4,200 feet per second. Without SRB, the ride is a lost cruiser, but the set motors laugh. Some dirt in the windows.
Discovery, first stage nominal performance, 2-engine tail.
43 miles downrange, velocity 7,200 feet per second.
Marshall, I am powering down MSL-3 now.
Payload specialist 2. Payload specialist 2, please begin power down of the astronomy telescopes and instruments.
Roger, flight. I am powering up all 5 computers.
Discovery. Fuel cell 3. Fire
and powered
up. And you are
going
for fuel cell 3 and power
up AB. Okay. Knowledge. Houston. I am powering up fuel cell 3. And ESS bus AB.
Interior and exterior temperatures nominal, Houston. The tiles are working great.
Discovery, prepare for loss of signal in 1 minute. Confirm loss.
Thank you.
shuttle launch is a team effort. The trainees exchange positions during their second simulation in order to gain a better understanding of each other's roles during a mission.
Roger, auto sequencer start.
T-minus 20 seconds, arming sound suppression system. T-minus 10 seconds, 8, 7, main engine start, 4, 3, 2, booster ignition, and liftoff of STS-35.
Roger, liftoff, engines at 104%.
Roger, Discovery, you have cleared the tower.
Begin roll program.
APU is running normal.
D's and all systems are nominal.
Stand by for throttle down at max Q.
Roger, max Q. Throttling down to 65%.
Velocity is at 1,400 feet per second. Altitude is 4 nautical miles. Downrange, 0.5 nautical miles.
Distance to 104%.
Discovery's altitude 22 nautical miles, 14 miles downrange. Velocity, 33.
Confirm burnout, and we have booster separation.
Roger, Discovery. Confirm SRB set.
Without the SRBs, the ride is a lot smoother, but the SEP motors are injured on the wheel. APU at full speed, Discovery, you are ready for deorbit.
Got started. Well, it started many, many years ago with a gentleman named Wernher von Braun. And it was his dream that if students could come and go to a baseball camp or a football camp or Boy Scout and Girl Scout camp in the summer, why couldn't they learn about science and go to some kind of a science camp? He felt that it was very important that America get their high technology founding very early in the educational system.
And now it is time for graduation. Each trainee has earned his or her wings. In celebration of their achievements, each receives a diploma certifying graduation from U.S. Space Camp.
My name is Glenn, and I had the pleasant experience of having Saturn team. I'd like to introduce him to you right now. From Lake Wales, Florida, Mission Specialist 1 and Payload EVA, David Hurst. From Dryden, Michigan, Payload Specialist 2, Ground Control Officer, Jeff Opalak. From Siler City, North Carolina, Commander and Principal Investigator, Brad Rim. From Voorhees, New Jersey, Payload Specialist 1, Payload EVA, Ted Hartman. From Dryden, Michigan, Payload Specialist 1, Flight Director, Brian Duffney. From Muskegon, Michigan, Pinko Pilot, Stephanie Fisher. Also from Muskegon, Michigan, Payload Specialist 2 and Ground Control Officer, Marcy Cunningham. From Mount Clemens, Michigan, Mission Scientist and Mission Specialist, Andy Bohr. From Siler City, Michigan, North Carolina, Mission Specialist 1 and 2 and Flight Director, Jason Grigg. From Venice, Florida, Commander, Principal Investigator, and Mission Scientist, Jason Clark. From Fairmount, West Virginia, my pilot and Inco, Becky Mundo. Thank you very much.